new chapter, you know, the night before. So I wrote it through my 20s, and then I remember when I decided to go to Brown to do an MFA. I wrote it as my thesis, and I sent it to two publishers. I sent it to Soho Press. They ended up publishing it. But the conversation, the whole publication was strange. So I remember Laura, my editor at Soho Press, called and said, you know, I only ended up reading your book because I was opening the envelope to write you like a rejection letter, but I couldn't figure out whether you were a man or a woman. So I didn't know who to write the rejection letter. Then she started reading it to figure out like whether I was a man or a woman, and then really got into it. So I was like, oh my God, chance. And then she says, well, we want to publish it. And stupid me, I was like, how much do I pay you? And so that killed the negotiations big time. But it was still published. And then years later, you know, it was, and I remember when it, you know, back then you could go into the bookstores on publication day. And I went through like Shakespeare and Company, and they had two copies. And everybody has said, which I think, I don't know if you do this, but everybody always says, when it's the spine first, get the book out and put it out, like put the cover in the aisle. I was like, that's obnoxious. So I never did it, but I went through all the bookstores, and then I couldn't actually believe it was a book. People really responded well, and then the book was on Oprah. But, you know, Laura gave me some great advice, and she said, the editor, she said, you know, before, and I ever since maybe you do this, because you seem like you always have so many things in the fire, but she said, do always have something started right before the next thing, because no matter how people respond to the last thing, whether they really like it or they really hate it, then you won't be affected as much. And I think so that's why, under all the response, I was able to, and I always pass that advice on to younger writers. I said, you know, have something going. What would you, do you do that?
Yeah, and I also don't read reviews. Mm-hmm. Do you read reviews?
I read reviews. You know why I read reviews? Because I feel like everybody else is reading it. Why not me? Like, because you might go to lunch. Like, it's sometimes it's like the elephant in the room, right? Like, you, if you've gotten a really bad one and you're going to lunch with your friend and you know she's read it, and you're like, so how do you avoid it in the age of the internet?
I don't Google myself.
Yeah. No, but I mean, it comes like in the, yeah.
Well, you know, before the internet, when the reviews were all print reviews, mm-hmm. I would ask my editor to only send me the good ones. Mm-hmm. So that kind of made me think I was doing really well. And now, I don't know. Yeah, you have to kind of look for them, though, right?
No, I think, like, I have the unfortunate thing of having friends who were like, hey, you got this review, and they forward it to me.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I should maybe do a rule. But I am curious about it. I think I'm curious, like, what people are saying, I guess, even if it's me. I don't do the Goodreads. Like, I spare myself that. Yeah, but.
And so how do you, I was talking with Chris Myers the other day, who we were singing your praises, and he was saying, one of the things I love about Edwidge is she's managed to just kind of stay out of all of this, all the social media, you know, Facebooking, Twittering, and she's just doing her thing and writing her books and being a mom and living in Florida. So is it that simple?
It's not that simple, but I'm not very good at the social media thing. And I do, in spite of exposing myself to reviews, I do a lot of hang-ringing. Like, I feel like if I were, like, Twittering a lot, then I would be like, oh, my God, I shouldn't have Twittered that. I don't know that. And also, when you, I think having small children, it's like when you do read the mean stuff, it kind of hurts you for a minute, mm-hmm. right? And I always feel like, okay, if it ruins my mood, I'm going to be mean to my kids, I'm going to, you know. And so I, it's not like, sometimes, you know, writers who don't do it, people think you're, you know, lofty or whatever. I think it's, for me, it's like, just like you're not reading the reviews, it's kind of whatever you need to do for your self-preservation, mm-hmm. for self-care, is that's, for me, that's part of it. I feel like if I were suddenly, it's hard enough getting into arguments with people in real life, and like if you were getting arguments with into virtual arguments too, it would just like affect, I feel like it would affect my mood too much, and it would affect my life. But then maybe I'm presuming that it would all be negative, you know. Maybe
I think you're really smart. Yeah, I think it's such a slippery slope, and you know, once you start getting caught up in it, it can just keep on going. And
you have to enjoy it, right? I think I know people who really love it, and it's part of their process. And it's not yet that for me. So, yeah.
So I wrote you a couple of months ago when I read about you and Juno Diaz and what was happening in the Dominican Republic, and speaking out against that and wanting to get on board to be a part of the movement to change what's going on. Can you talk about that a little?
Well, I mean, it's a couple of years ago, there was a court decision that was taken in the Dominican Republic in terms of immigration, to return to their 1929 constitution, which then had the result of rendering stateless thousands and thousands of people, most of them Dominicans of Haitian descent. And because there was a lot of outcry, then the government came up with a plan in which people could, you know, people who had been citizens of this country for generations, I could now then re-register for, as a result of that, there were a lot of deportations, but they were also what they were calling self-deportation, but deport people who left as a result of, and you know, intimidations and threats, and so Juno, God bless him, you know, we've been talking about this since the 90s, because the last time you had a big deportation campaign was like within the 90s, where people were just basically picked up and dumped at the border. And so we've just continued to talk about it, because it's a human rights issue. It's an issue that I sometimes think these things are floated and tested, and especially in our hemisphere, that if we allow it to happen there, other people in other places, other countries can feel like they can also reproduce. And so, you know, we've been very vocal about it. You get a lot of backlash for it, especially him. He's taken a lot of heat for it. But I think if you think about it in terms of the states, it's as if suddenly they said, okay, if your grandparents, everybody who came here after, 1929, is lost their citizenship. You know, it's the equivalent of that.
Well, thank you for that. Thanks for the work. Brother, I'm Dying, the memoir about your uncle, which was so lovely and so thoughtful and so painful. And in the end, it felt so cathartic to me. It felt like I was on that journey with you and had lived through something amazing. I know you get asked this all the time, but how do you do it?
Well, I mean, I'm curious to know how you do it too, because you go to some very difficult places with us in your work as well. But I think it's like, it feels like, how do you not do it, right? And I think we are drawn to these stories part of out of passion, out of love, out of concern. And this was the most personal story of all to me, because it's Brother, I'm Dying is a memoir about that's written about this year where my father was dying of pulmonary fibrosis. My uncle had died in immigration jail, and my oldest daughter, Mira, was being born. So it was sort of this year of the cycle of life, but about immigration policy, about the history of my family, both in Haiti and sort of the short history that we have here in the United States. So I just feel like I could not do it, you know, and it was a way of processing it for me. It was therapeutic. It was a way of learning more about a system that a lot of people get get caught up, and how about you? How do you write about difficult subjects?
You know, it's so funny because whenever someone says, oh, you had such a hard life, when they read Brown Girl Dreaming or something, and I'm like, my life wasn't hard. You know, it's so interesting because it is, it's my life, and I have, what do I have to compare it to? And it didn't feel hard. It doesn't feel hard at the time. But when you see someone else's gaze on it and their gaze makes it feel like this tragic thing, it isn't that, right? It's what it is. It's that moment and you in that moment and you able to step outside of that moment to write about it for, as you say, your own salvation. Mm-hmm. Because once you understand that moment, it makes you able to move through the world differently and with a bigger gaze. Mm-hmm. And I always think about the people who have lived these lives where they haven't had a lot of experiences. And what are they going to write? I want to be writers. I mean, I think about when I used to teach writing, and people had the tools, but they didn't have the story. And I feel like for so many years, I had the story without the tools, and eventually they came together. But I couldn't imagine the world without Brother, I'm Dying in it. I can't imagine myself as a writer without having had that book as a tool for my own storytelling. So
thank you.
You know, I just can't say enough how much your work has changed so many people's worlds, but also for me in terms of thinking about the stuff you've written about and how you've written it, even with the use of the Haitian patois and people being afraid to bring their own language to literature, thinking, and what Juno did with the Spanish and Spanglish, and bringing that to the literature and saying that these works matter, that people of color telling these stories in the ways that we know how to tell these stories matter. Mm-hmm. And when you were writing in the 90s, I mean, when you were first beginning, there weren't a lot of books by people of color out there doing that. So you also opened doors for people. I know we kind of came along at the same time in the early 90s when, as I say, the bodega doors opened. And they said, okay, people of color, come in, we'll
Let's
publish your
stories. Let's bring as many of us in as we can. Yeah.
Before they close it again.
Yeah, and well, and I can't imagine a world without you know, Brown Girl Dreaming. I'm curious about, in terms of storytelling strategies, why did you decide to use the
verse form?
Yeah,
I think mainly because it was memory, and I wanted, and when you think of memory, you think of these small moments with all of this white space around it, and not always knowing how one memory is connected to the next, but knowing also that the white space is so important to the story because it's kind of that lull, and it's kind of that thinking, and it's kind of that movement that's happening off the page. So I thought because I didn't remember it as this happened here, this happened there, this happened, I would feel dishonest putting it on the page that way. So that's, and also whenever I write, it has to look a certain way on the page, but also sound a certain way. So it was about thinking about if I break the line here, then when the reader reads this line, they're going to have to pause for a moment, and that line's going to become a picture in their mind, and then they're going to go to the next one, and that same thing's going to happen until the whole story is both very visual, but also something they can hear.
Mm-hmm. I give your book to both brown and non-brown little girls, and actually one of my daughter's friends, after she read it, my daughter said, it's your mommy's story, right?
Great.
So it's universal.
We're going to open it up to questions in just a moment. I just want to ask Edwidge two more questions. So I've read you BC, before children, and now AC.
AC.
How has your writing process changed as a mom?
Well, it's interesting. I once heard someone ask Jumpa Lahiri that this question, and she said, "You have more to write about, but less time to." And I think that basically really sums it up. I mean, it's the one thing, you know, AC after children is I feel like my heart is just bigger than my body, right? You feel like your heart is really expanded, but you have to be a really good time manager now. And I was one of those writers who was like a night writer. But, you know, now I know, like, conscience, like, okay, if I stay up all night, I still have to get up at 6:30 and do the school round thing. So, I mean, it's. I think that sums it up. How about for you?
It's the same thing. If the kids, well, I have my partner who's here who helps a lot. But if you are getting all that information, and you can't really use it because they get mad at you anyway, right? If you wrote about them, so you have to not be conscious that you're actually writing about your own children, so then you're not lying when you say to them, that's not you. But but it is also, I think, when they're on vacation and stuff, and I know I can sleep late, I can stay up later writing. Mm-hmm. But I do feel like I've gotten much more. I manage time. I'm a writer while they're at school, and then when close to the time they're coming home, I have to go back to being mom and not be in the head of my characters.
Yeah, and I've always wanted to be conscious. Also, my girls and my husband are watching on the live stream. Hello, and I've one of the things I've always been conscious because I've read Generation Past about writers who are like, you know, no kids, you are not a big obstacle to my. You know, to also reinforce, I think that it's really a gift, and also that I would say young writers who are, if you're thinking of, you know, having children, to pick a really great partner, yeah. And a partner, yeah. In all of the sense of someone who really can help you pick up the load, to make that, because you realize too that it becomes a family affair, mm-hmm. Right? That we can be here or we can go off because there's someone wonderful,
yes.
At home taking care of things. Yeah,
it is true. And also because they get your crankiness. Yeah. You know, when you're in that writer's head, your partners know it's not about you.
I know. It's like, I can see you really.
Yeah.
Just get out of my way.
So it does.
Yeah.
It does mean picking someone who can be in it with you, because it's not easy being with writers. And so what are you working on? Do you talk about what you're working on?
I do, because, I mean, I do when I'm, like, in a good place in it, and this I'm in a good place in. So about a year and a half ago, my mom passed away, and then I started reading all these books, like A Grief Observed and memoirs, what some folks are calling memoirs, about people who's lost their moms. And then I came across this series that Grey Wolf Press does. It's called The Art Of, on craft. And then so when I started reading, I proposed to them to do like The Art of Death. So I'm writing it's like a long essay about how writers, and including myself and others, have written about grief and death. Mm. So it's been really therapeutic doing it. I just finished a draft of it. It's been really good processing it, sort of getting some of the grief out, and it's I have a similar feeling when I was done with this book as I did when I finished Brother, I'm Dying, because when you write about the dead, especially the close to you dead, you know, it's like visiting with them,
mm-hmm.
You know, and I felt that too in Brown Girl Dreaming, sort of the flow of the ancestors and the people who have brought us here, and so I, writing that and just seeing how different people have dealt with that and kind of surviving grief has been a good in-between project.
And when will that be out?
It'll be summer 17.
Wow.
Yeah, si Dieu veut, God willing, as we say. Yeah.
Oh, that's congratulations.
Thank you.
So, questions from the audience. We have the mic.
Hi, Edwidge, and thank you so much, Jacqueline, for the insightful questions. One thing I wanted to ask you, I'm also Haitian American, and one of the joys of reading your books is, you know, I think you're one of the few authors that really encapsulates this feeling of living in two different worlds, two different cultures. And I mean, I'm assuming that you're spending more time in the U.S., you're raising children here. Now, do you find yourself viewing yourself as being more American? And also as your, I guess your mom recently passed away, your, you know, other family members who, you know, had that connection or brought you that connection to Haiti, do you find yourself feeling more American or just really changing this, the way you saw, you see yourself in terms of culturally?
Well, I think culturally my feeling has not changed since I got here, sort of being, you know, Haitian American and being in between. I think, but this notion, and you know this, and this bears out in your work too, is that it's sort of like what it means to be American for people like us is sort of sometimes not up to us to decide, you know. And so I wrestle with that too. Means, but Haiti remains, you know, a place that's very close to me, like home. We go back all the time. My family, we all go back. I still have a lot of family there, so Haiti will always be a big part of my life. But I understand too. I mean, that is a concern as the generations go on, and certainly for a while I felt, you know, very unstable. So after the earthquake, that my uncle's house was no longer there, you know. So there was you lose those physical connections as people die, as the place is no longer. But I was lucky that you build new connections, you know, with in-laws and with other family members, and so that. That connection is one that is not going to change for me, and one that I'm also trying to pass on to my children. And the most important thing for me was that they would see Haiti as like any other place, you know, because sometimes in the diaspora, we ourselves frighten our kids off of Haiti, so that they could go, and it's like, it's like any other place that we've been, but we have this special connection to it.
Hi, I have two questions that are quite unrelated to each other. I know a lot of your writing grapples with the sociopolitics of identity, but if you could comment without being politically correct on a statement that I read. I was at Brooklyn Museum last night, and I read something that kind of moved me, and that somehow I kind of, you know, that's something that I perhaps may also share. It said, that statement read, there can be no country, there can be no freedom in a country that is based on slavery and genocide. This is my first question. If you could just comment on it, as I said, without being politically correct. Number two, are there any Indian writers, that is, writers from India, that have influenced you, or you've been inspired or impressed by their writings? If yes, then why and how? And if no, then why not?
You have to answer the... I mean, to the first one, without being politically correct, I mean, there can be no freedom for everybody in any country that's based on slavery and genocide. And I think we're still wrestling with those questions. Freedom, you know, freedom, citizenship, citizenry was defined differently for different people. You know, when you were considered one-fifth of a person, of course the foundation of the nation was not intended for you. And I think that's why these struggles continue through the civil rights movement, now through Black Lives Matter. We're still, you know, there's in The Farming of Bones, one of the characters says, freedom is a passing thing. Someone can always come and take it away. I mean, I think all these movements were meant to pick up the bat and keep up these struggles, you know. So I think freedom is never an absolute. In terms of Indian writers, I know sometimes when people ask and you say the diaspora writers, they get mad. Like, so you're not going to get mad if I say Jhumpa, if you consider
love Jhumpa.
Or Owen wrote one amazing thing. Chitra.
Roxana. I forgot Chitra's last name.
Chitra. But if you, I would appreciate if you had some recommendations. Mm-hmm. I'm very much open to reading more Indian writers.
And I know Roxana Khan, who writes a lot for younger people.
And Mina Alexander, poet. Yeah. Good. Into the freedom question without being politically correct.
So I think the same thing. When you look at the history that our country was built on, it was built on a system of people wanting to own other people. And the fact that we survived that, I think, makes a lot of people mad. And so, and for us, I think it does build toward our own strength and what we give our children in terms of saying we weren't meant to survive in this country, and we did, and we are surviving, and we're still fighting. And it's going to be interesting to see what freedom looks like in 50 years here, or 100 years if we're still here. I think it is a journey. I think our freedom in this country is an absolute journey that we're still very much on, and who knows how long we'll be on it.
Hi, my I have more of a comment than a question. I'm first generation Haitian American. My name is Patricia Benato. Nice to meet you. And I just wanted to say that you've been such a great influence in my life. I started college when I was 16 in 91. And shortly afterwards, I started reading your works. And my family, I feel like they didn't necessarily encourage the Haitian culture in my life. And you opened that to me in a way that when I would read patois in the book, I was like, oh my God, this is my language. And your writing has never bored me. And through the years, I'm a groupie. I tell my girlfriend, excuse me, but I'm going to be a groupie for a moment. And I just want to say thank you for the influence that you've had in my life. And I had never been, you know, in the 90s, I didn't go to Haiti. My family was like, it's too much turmoil. It's too heavy to go there right now. So I went to Haiti for the first time last year. Volunteered at an orphanage, and I was at Gangouave, and it was the most beautiful experience, and I felt like I was in one of your books. And I thank you for the connection that you create for us who are born here but had not been to Haiti yet, because when I went to Haiti, it was the most beautiful book I've never read. And I just want to say thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you. It's funny. Thank you so much. You know, it's funny, as you were speaking, I see some children gazing at their parents like, see, I can go, she went. So that's wonderful. Thank you.
Hi, good day. Thank you to the presenter, and thank you, Mrs. Danticat. I also want to piggyback on what this young woman said. I started reading your books in college about 10, 12 years ago, and I must say that all of your prose is, to me, scrumptious. No, it's filling. And my question is more so on your writing process. Sometimes I just wonder, are you that exceptional a writer just by yourself? And or are you that exceptional of a writer that also has a great editor? Because I feel like not one word is out of place. Every word is where it needs to be for the imagery. And I'm a groupie as well, so. I am not of Haitian descent. I am born and raised in Brooklyn, raised right here, Park Slope, Prospect Leopards Gardens, Prospect Heights. My dad still lives across the street. And I mean, I'm a native Brooklynite, so, you know, there are famous people throughout Brooklyn. We rep this hard body. But you're the only person that I feel like I'm going to run into in the street. You're the only person, like, whose face that I'm expecting to see in the crowd because you're Haitian American. So you're either in Brooklyn or in Florida. So, that's just what it is, you know? So we fangirl for you. And I just wonder, what is your writing process like? Because every word is scrumptious. It's just, I literally eat your books. No, I'm serious. I eat them. They're filling. The first time I came across your book was The Farming of Bones in a Caribbean literature class that I took in college. I said, I left Brooklyn to go to Nebraska, and I said, if I'm going to be in Nebraska and I'm going to pay tuition, I want to learn about me. I had kindergarten through 12th grade to learn about other. I'm interested in me. And amongst Paula Marshall, amongst everyone else, you feel me. So what is it? Does it come from your toes? Does it come from your toes and extend your pores?
I'm
going to
recite to Maya Angelou now.
Yeah. Where does it come from? Thank you.
Oh, you're very kind. Thank you so much. Since my editor is not here, I'm going to take all the credit. It's all me. Well, thank you. But it's funny, and I'm sure you have the same feeling, Jacqueline. It's like sometimes you just feel like you're a vessel, right, for it, like it comes through. And it's, I do work really hard at my prose. I'm like a relentless editor of my own work. And maybe it's part of it is because I'm lucky that I also have this Creole that's behind my English. And those of you who speak Creole know Creole is a very poetic language. It's full of imagery. It's full of these proverbs. And Creole is one of those languages that's you could have a conversation so many levels that sometimes you're talking to someone and they're talking about a whole different thing if they're using the right imagery. And then you're like on this other, if you're literal and they're being, poetic, you could be like, hey, what just happened? Because it's such a, it's a language that lends itself to a lot of poetry. So I think that's being behind the English that I'm writing has something to do with it too. I do a lot of editing. And part of it is because it's my third language. English is my third language, so I'm just always trying to make sure that I'm clear. And so, but the rest of it is, is God. It's the universe. It's the ancestors. It's what comes through. And there are times when I do feel like I am a vessel that sort of like that it's coming through. I know that sounds very mystical, but it's. I think there's that in creativity as well. Yeah. What do you think?
I think the same thing. I mean, and I think the writers in the room know that. That moment when you're like, I don't know how this just got on the page, but I'm just letting it come through me and into the world. And it is, I felt that with Brown Girl Dreaming, like you said, you feel like there are other people in the room with you, helping you to tell the story. And I think it is about being open to the language and not being fearful of what the story you're writing is becoming. And I never outline. Do you outline?
Mm-mm.
Yeah, no. I think a part of my fear of outline is that I'll get so caught up in that outline and I won't let the story do what it needs to do. So I think it does come from that fearlessness that you have in order to tell stories.
Yeah, and you have to, sometimes you have to pretend that nobody's going to read it.
Mm-hmm.
So you can lose that censor, the self-censor, yeah.
Hi, Jackie. I'll say groupies as opposed to stalker because like, oh my God, her again, what the hell? But thank you both for your contributions to the literary world. They're very important and it's wonderful to have our voices personified through your vessel or being, you guys doing it for us. My question is kind of related to what you were just talking about. It's more about the process. I've dipped in and out of writing or trying to be a writer. And you're both saying that, you have to write at this time of night because the kids are asleep or someone's on vacation. How do you, whenever I've written, I've been inspired to write. And so then I get it down. If I had to, schedule it, I don't know how I would do that. And so how do you manage to schedule your creativity into times where you can be productive?
You got all that time. You got that college age daughter now. I think of writing as a muscle, right? So you have to use it in there, those periods of times when you don't want to work your muscles, that you still have to work them. And so I have to, When I sit down to write, I'll reread stuff I wrote. I always listen to music. So my headphones go on, the music's on. I get out of the world and into the page. And so that piece of inspired writing, I have to sit with it and see and figure out what more is coming out of it. And it is, and sometimes there's a lot of junk that comes before I get to the voice that I'm working to get to in that set period of time. And sometimes it's writing something down in the middle of the night and then hoping that the next morning it sounds as great as it did. But the ideas, I really do feel like there are times when I have to write because I have to write. I have to get it out of me. Now is the time.
And I think you also have to write around the life you have, mm-hmm. right? And sometimes when people ask, well, about process, they want you to give them a formula. So then often many writers will say, I need to write with a Mont Blanc by the beach with candles lit, right? And not all of us can do that. So you have to write around the life you had. And I used to be like Jacqueline said, you know, BC, I was a binge writer. So I could just like, I was just like, I would write the thing until it was done, neglecting everything in my life. I can't do that anymore. So you have to write around the life you have. And I think one of the least discussed aspects of creativity is discipline. You have to have some discipline, right? You have to impose that on yourself. You have to say, okay, if it's 2 hours a day, I'm going to write 2 hours a day. And I love those stories. You always hear the stories of these writers who are like, they had a full-time job, they would wake up at 3:30 to 5:30, and they write their novel, now it's sold 10 million copies. I love those stories. And they do happen. But I think what to me, the emphasis in that story is the discipline part of it, is that really you make a commitment to that, just like you make a commitment to everything else. And just as you write when you're inspired, sometimes I don't want to sit down, but I make myself, and something comes out that's wonderful that I feel like I would have lost if I had not made myself sit down during that uninspired period.
So true.
Hi, Jackie. I happened to see you when you did a presentation at Trinity Church in Lower Manhattan, and I remember how uncomfortable you seemed. And I just wanted to let you know this time you seem a lot more comfortable in this dynamic. And it could have a lot to do with the person who's there with you. And I'm always amazed. I remember I missed my train stop reading Farming of the Bones. I kept glancing up and then realized that my stop, 14th Street, Union Square, the doors closed. But I had got to a part in the book that it had pulled me in, and to be honest with you, I surrendered to that, and I didn't mind that I had to get off the next stop and turn right back around and come back.
Thank you.
If that your words and the process and the finished product can pull me in that way, when do you know, because you said it is about pretty much knowing when to not censor, or when to get up in the middle of the night because that perfect verse is right there and you want to jot it down before you lose it. But I guess my question is, when do you know when it's time to shut that down, when you have to step back from it, take a vacation from it, and what do you do to do that, and then what do you do to re-energize yourself and go on to your next project?
Well, I mean, it's like all the writing books have that section, when do you know it's over, right? I know it's over when I'm putting the same things back in, that I'm taking the same things out, and also I don't, like, the emotional thing is like, the hard things, I don't stop at those moments. And I know the people who sit, when I'm reading the book, I get up and walk away. For me, I try not to to walk away from those very painful moments in the writing. And sometimes the book will tell you, like, if you get stuck in the middle, you're like, okay, maybe it's time for me to go back and reread or take a break and things like that. But that, to me, it's like the ending is when, okay, I feel like I'm spinning around in that same place. How about for you?
Yeah, it's such an emotional journey. And I feel like, you know, when I get to the hard places and I'm writing and I feel like I'm on the verge of tears, it's easy to stop and say, I don't want to go here right now. But that moment is always going to be there. You have to write through it and have that emotional journey to get to that finish line. And I and there are days when I'm like, you know what, I don't want to be sad today, or I don't want to be angry. But it means the book not getting done. I try to work on more than one thing at a time, so that if I'm feeling like I don't want to be in one place in one book, I can move on to something else and work on that and be somewhere else emotionally. I know it's done. I feel it when it's done. You read that last sentence and you know the book has said what it needs to say. And then it's done. And I read everything out loud, so I can hear it. I can hear that last sentence kind of ending the story. And when it doesn't, I definitely feel it. It's not ready yet.
Do you read in a cassette, or do you read just that? Because I know Walter Mosley reads out loud too, but he says he reads in a cassette and then listens to the cassette.
Oh no, I can't stand my voice on record.
You would be like, this is all bad. Yeah.
Delete.
So for Jacqueline and Edwidge, we have two more audience questions. Is that okay?
That's cool. Then
once again, we'll have a signing. Community Books is in the lobby, and the signing table is in the wing of the lobby over there. So one up front and one in the back, and then we'll get to the signing.
I'd like to thank both of you for sharing yourselves and your lives with us today. My question is for Edwidge. Do you write in Creole? And if you have you been published, and what has the reaction to that been?
Okay. I haven't written in Creole, so it's a sort of a long story that I'll keep short. So when I was growing up, we would, at home, I spoke Creole at home. And then I would go to school, you would speak French. And at that time, you weren't really taught to write Creole. So I was speaking a language I didn't write. I was writing a language I didn't speak. So that was basically my experience. So I haven't written text in Creole. Also, having the hesitation of when I have tried, and I've tried and I've written things in Creole, and you read them, and people are like, oh, that's diaspora Creole. You know, that's not real Creole. Mm-hmm. So I think that's made me a little bit shy to try, but some of the stories and Krikrak we did as radio plays in Creole. So I did the translation, and then they were played on Haitian radio. And that was a really interesting experience, because I ended up writing something totally different. It sort of became something else. So even for me, it was a really good exercise. So those people responded pretty well too. But there's a great deal of literature now in Creole. A lot of poetry, which was the usual, sort of what people mostly wrote in Creole in, but now some short stories and novels as well.
Hi, I am Deborah. I am a first generation American, and I just want to thank you for your stories. My only book that I read from you is Breath, Eyes, Memory so far. I will read more. Mm-hmm. But it helped me understand what my siblings went through. I'm the youngest of five. I call myself the oops baby, because my family migrated here in 74, and oops, in 78, here I came. And I felt a little distance from my siblings, only in that they had something to share that I didn't know of. And it helped me kind of see their life as youngins in the Caribbean. My family's from Dominica. And it helped me kind of connect with them, and I shared the book with them, and they adore your books. Mm-hmm. And I actually have one for you to sign for my sister, so I want to thank you for your stories. It helped me connect to Dominica. I am now a dual citizen of Dominica. It just helped me, you know, obtain more interest in my country and in my culture, and I wish my parents taught me our patois, that we'd speak there as well. I know it's a broken form of Creole as well. But I also had a question regarding Untwine. I've been reading it and so fascinated by it, and I just wanted to know, where did you get that story from? Was it personal experience, or was it just a fictitious thought, or it just seems so intimate, and I just want to know where that came from.
All right, thank you for your kind words. Before I go to Untwine, I think your story is a very interesting story, because also it's the story of my family, right? There were, and so many other families, where you have siblings who were born in the Caribbean, and the siblings who were born in the States, and sometimes, like, the families, they have to come together, you know, across language barriers. And I think that's a story that so many Caribbean families go through. So it's nice that there's some kind of some ways to bridge that, because for some families a lot of work that never is quite completed. So for Antoine, you know, I started writing part of Antoine at the same time as I was writing Breath Eyes Memory. My initial, and I think this is the first time I'm like confessing this to you. My initial like desire was to write YA, like to be Jacqueline Woodson. So, and then, because I thought, okay, what's the best time to write YA when you're close to being a young adult? So I started writing a version of that in my, like, in, you know, early, like, really, like, 20s. And I put it away because, and I kept reading other, like, so it was about this girl who was in love with this choir director, and then I kept reading stories that were like it, like, and I was like, oh, I can't do this. And then, so finally, I picked it up back when my mom was sick. I picked up that manuscript, and then I started when I was processing through, you know, they say like when someone, my mom was diagnosed with terminal ovarian cancer. So you go through when you lose when you're losing a loved one like that. And my father died of like a terminal illness that took a long time too. So you go through this whole process of anticipatory grief, like where you're anticipating your grief. And so I started writing part of this, you know, when my mom was sleeping in the hospital and the thing. So I feel like it's intimate, I think, because it's like me and her. You know, the twins are like us. So it's kind of like emotionally our story.
Well, then I think we're going to wrap up and get to our signing. Will you please thank them again for coming to Brooklyn?
Thank you.
And on behalf of the Brooklyn Public Library, I'm Joel Whitney. Thank you for coming to the Dweck Auditorium. Thank you for watching on the live stream. Thank you to our sound and photography gurus, Greg and Victor. And Community Books is here to sell their books, and you can get them signed in the lobby. Thanks again.